Alright guys, let's open Harlem, shall we?
Yeah.
So, everyone, welcome to Vilnius, to Lithuania, to Harlem 2017. This is the 12th edition. So nice to see you as always. Who's here more than five times? Raise your hands. More than four times? Three times? More than two times? The first time? This year, the 12th year, and we had a record actually. We have 38 countries coming.
Wow.
Yeah, that's the most we ever had. And we're gonna have amazing 4 days, and I will give you some details of our extra things that you can all things you can find is in the app, right? Or the link you can find in the Harlem website. So it's a day program. For the additional things, on Friday we're gonna have taster shag class at the beginning of the party at Legendos Club at 8 o'clock by Arnas and Agle. Right, so it's a open, it's a free class to everyone. Right, then we have on Friday and Sunday. We have tea dances in Piano Man outside, right? It's open open space with the music, with the drinks and the food. So if you want to chill, you're welcome to be there. Friday starts at 5 until 7:30, and then on Sunday it starts at 3 until 7:30. Right? So welcome to the tea dances. Also. On the Saturday after Lindy trip at 5, we have a flash mob dance in the Cathedral Square. So I hope you guys have your routine ready for the flash mob. If not, you still have time. And actually, you have space. If you want to practice something, or maybe prepare something, or practice for the competition, one hall. Class venue will be open for the entire day. You can go there and practice. You can find this information in the PDF book file. All right. What else? If you are not signed up for the our Ultimate Best Dancers competition, you are still able to do this. Also for all competitions. But especially for this one, you need to be in the Legendos Club at by 8:15. This is when the registration closing. All right. And now I wanna introduce our lecture hosts. They will talk about. They will give you some insights and stories and clips on. Old-timers, and I want to welcome Mikey and Peter.
Thank you. It's amazing to see so many first-time people here.
That's awesome.
That's amazing. I was surprised, actually. For the first-timers, welcome. This is an amazing event. It's obviously been around for many years, or 12 years to be exact. I don't know how long I've been here.
I think this is my fourth year, I think, here in a row, which is awesome.
So welcome, you guys. We were just talking to some people out front. One of the special things about this event is they're always trying to make it pure live music with as little DJs as possible.
Yeah, definitely.
And that is really, really cool. So you guys will see an amazing band list this year, and that's something I think we both have always applauded.
Yeah, definitely, especially at the Legends Club or New. I'm you call it whatever you want. It's still New York Club to me. Okay. Yeah. I said that the other day to a message to Martinez. I was like, yeah, New York Club, and I'm pretty sure he went, oh, okay. But yeah, so in this lecture today, we're gonna get started with it. We're gonna be talking about the old timers and their influence on us, and how we see their point of views influenced what the scene is today. And now by old timers, we mean that totally in a lovingly way as possible. Like, you know, hey, old timer, not like that. It's like, my old timer, my papa, my grandpa. How do you say grandpa in Lithuanian? How do you say grandma? Senela? Senelis? Sanis? Sanis? Coded in.
Sanis Patris.
Is that you, really? I mean, it's... I mean, for a long time, my friend.
I don't know if it's bad or good anymore. I don't care.
So we're going to be talking about a couple of them. A couple of them you might know, a couple of them you might not know. We're going to go into video clips. We're going to talk about their quotes, some things they've said, and then give our point of view of how we feel it's being implemented today, or if we see it at all today. Okay? So we're going to jump right into it with someone you should know. If you don't know, use Google. It's a thing. I know it's in Lithuania. I know it's here. It just arrived yesterday. By rocks. Frankie Manning.
The ambassador of Lindy Hop.
The ambassador
right.
of Lindy Hop.
One thing that's interesting to note, me and Mikey here, we're from Los Angeles, California. Or
yeah, yeah.
Right, right. And we have our own history. And our California history is very, very different than the rest of America, obviously. Mm-hmm. It's like saying Vilnius is like Amsterdam. Right, you have two different histories.
Way different.
Well, that's New York and Los Angeles. We had our own, our old timers that we looked up to, yeah. Not only in person, but first I think in film, mm-hmm. and then we discovered that they were still alive.
Yeah,
and we were like, wow, these guys are cool, and that's who we learned from.
Yeah,
and then we heard about this Lindy Hop scene that's somewhere in the around the world or yeah. something, and there's this black guy, and he runs it, and his name is Frankie Manning.
Oh yeah, he runs it.
And so it's a completely different history between Los Angeles and New York. But today, we all kind of think of the same, it's all part of the, I hate to say it, the Lindy Hop scene, even though it's not. Today, around the world, it is though, correct, would you say?
We're like 5 minutes into it, and you're already disagreeing with yourself.
Right. Well, there's reality, and then there's history.
Yeah, 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 it works.
So as we go through this list of old-timers, they're not all necessarily Lindy Hoppers.
Right.
But they were all swing dancers.
Exactly, that's what I was saying.
And Frankie Manning is who we consider we know he's, I call him the king of Lindy Hop, but
yeah.
I think
for sure that he earned that title, and I think not only did he earn it with the way, with the things he did, the way he taught, his influence on all of us, and if you don't know who he was, I think he earned the praises of all of his fellow dancers at the time. And when they were asked, you know, who was the best, they would usually say, if they wouldn't say themselves, they would say Frankie, pretty much every time.
And we all, I think many of you look at YouTube videos of many of the old time great dancers, be them tap dancers or swing dancers, bucking bubbles, and you know, all the old timers, I like to think, they all left some type of legacy on the dance.
Yeah.
And then it comes to Frankie Manning. Frankie Manning's legacy, we could honestly say, is he created this very, very unique thing called the Lindy Hop scene. He's not the first, of course, but he was the one that got hired first, of course, by the Swedes, then the British, in the 80s, mm-hmm. as they were all trying to embrace this dance. And it snowballed, basically, one event after the next. And here is a guy who is in retirement.
Yeah.
From working at the post office for 30 some odd years, and now he starts teaching all over the world. And today, the reason we know you is all because of Frankie Manning.
Because every time he had a birthday, he had like 10 birthdays a year, and they would be all over the world, and they would have these giant dance events. And then it got bigger every year, and they had for more teachers and more teachers, and they're like, well, let's invite this Peter Loggins guy. He talks a lot, it's really good. And then it's like, oh, there's like a little brown guy over here too. They invite him over. But one of his great legacies, I think, and we talked about this, and to clarify, we want to say that he did do one of the first air steps in a dance contest It's kind of like putting an asterisk on top of it, like in a dance context. We don't know for sure because I feel like it's like a thing that should have been happening. People throwing each other around.
Right. Well, and the thing is this: when you first heard the story about Frankie doing the air step, Frankie was the first one to do an air step in a contest at the Savoy, and then the story spreads amongst all of us, and it becomes Frankie was the first to do an air step at the Savoy. And then we spread it more, and then it becomes Frankie was the first to ever do an air step. You know, and so we are kind of, all of us, myself included, we're kind of guilty of shortening the stories.
Yeah. A lot of these stories we hear, we need to take with a grain of salt. That's kind of maybe an English term about it, but the remember that it's just like maybe half of the truth of what happened in that time. So remember that stuff, especially when we tell these tall tales.
Jazz history is full of contradictions
missed opportunities as well. Contradictions and missed opportunities, like especially like we give a lot of it to Frankie, but who was his partner that he actually flipped?
Right.
Does anybody know? Frieda Washington. Exactly. I mean, that's the point. You're like, wait, did he flip somebody?
He just flipped himself. Anybody. Yeah. Could have been anybody.
Yeah, but I mean, him.
What was her name?
Frieda Washington. Exactly.
Did he throw her?
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah, it was really great. She said yes. They put a mattress on the ground. So he says this story. But we have a lot to thank for him. And what we're gonna see now, we're gonna see one of his videos. Oh, we're gonna do the quote first.
We have a Frankie quote.
So what we're gonna do is a lot of these things is gonna be. Things that these old timers said, or that we've heard them say in an interview, or that we've had personal interaction with, and then we're going to talk about our stories beyond that. So his quote for here is, everybody at the Savoy had their own style.
Very important quote.
I know, right? You had to put on your glasses and everything.
Yeah, well, I had to make sure which quote are you reading.
So everybody at the Savoy had their own style, and this is very funny. Again, we're talking very specific. He's not saying everybody in Harlem. He's saying everybody at the Savoy. So when you think about that, I like to think about not the whole Lindy Hop community as it is today. I like to think of it as every dance event or every festival or every time I go out dancing. It's only this small microcosm that I'm only thinking in that moment. And so every time I see there, I sit at a dance event and I may not be dancing, I'm still watching. And I'm looking at everybody in the crowd. I'm seeing what's happening, seeing what things are being popularized, seeing things that are happening over and over again. It's like, oh, I think maybe someone taught that move in that class yet, because everybody's pointing up every time they finish an eight. You know, stuff like that is really poignant. If you can look out into a crowd and pick out the ones that you feel are actually being originators of this dance and not just kind of following the rest. That's, to me, what it feels like to have your own style.
Right, and it's very easy to, anybody in here can look at a room of dancers and see what the similarities are, and also you could look at the other side and see what the differences are. And I think it's really hard to put ourselves in their shoes and see what the differences are, because we all subscribe to the same swing out today, for the most part. We all let go on five or somewhere, you know. Whereas in the 30s, it would have been completely different. And also, this has a lot to do with the fact that every generation is a little bit different, but in the 30s, it was very much important to be original and very different. So much to a degree that's really hard for us to understand, that you can't even social dance with somebody else. That's how original their dancing was in the 30s. It was so unique between them and their partners that they couldn't do that with the public. Frankie's the perfect example if you've read his book. He didn't do the Lindy Hop when he danced with the public. He would do dances like the Foxtrot or the Walk or whatever. And then he did his Lindy Hop with his set group of people that knew the dance. So there's always it's like looking at a negative. You can see the dance from either side. Not one is better necessarily than the other, but it just shows you where the dance has gone today. We don't look for originality as being number one. We look for technique today, or we look for difficulty, or we look for musicality. We look for other things. But originality has taken a back seat, like it was in the 30s, to a lot of these other things. And it's very interesting.
No, it totally is. I absolutely agree with you on this. I I feel in my optimistic way that they're like, there's people being original, yeah, but it is a very small sect. If there's anybody that teaches out there locally, like we want to greatly encourage you to remember the idea of this dance being an original idea by each individual person. So we could teach all of our own feelings and techniques and ideas and moves in a class, but at the end of the day, it's up to that person if they're going to retain something or maybe change it in their mind. So it's better that we encourage that, and instead of being like the best dancer you could possibly be, is like just make shit up and have fun with it, yeah? And that's going to be the best way you can actually be a good dancer, okay?
Can I take that?
Take that to what?
I'm going to teach, just make shit up.
Yeah,
that's a good one.
I mean, you're going to start now? I feel like you've always been doing that.
No. I always tell people that if you don't know what to do, just think, what would Snoop Dogg do?
What would Snoop Dogg do?
Yeah, I always stop with Snoop Dogg.
Smoke a little joint.
Relax.
And then start dancing
again.
Maybe, yeah. So now we're going to take a look at a clip of Frankie and Willem A. Ricker dancing. Did you guys notice that he was dancing backwards instead of his left hand, he was dancing with his right hand? It wasn't on purpose, the video was flipped. Okay.
Yeah.
In that clip, it's really just perfect because he's not wearing the normal everyday clothes of the 1950s. That was some absurd moves, so that was the 1950s. He's 51, thank you. And he's wearing like shiny clothes. He's wearing like little glittery stuff. And even Willem A. Ricker is wearing nice stuff. Right? When we think about Lindy Hop, a lot of times we think about Hell's a Poppin'. That's not true, because what they wore in Hell's a Poppin' was a bunch of white people telling them what they needed to wear so they can be on screen with a bunch of white people. You know, so that's the weird stuff. When you see that,
costumes,
exactly, but they're being forced on. They're still being forced on.
Well,
this is something that at least showcases how beautiful.
I've never been in a movie that I could tell the casting director what I could wear. And I've been in a couple.
Yeah, me too.
Wear my own clothes.
Me too, but I mean, they always put me in nice clothes, not in a waiter's outfit.
I wasn't in nice clothes.
Well, it's okay.
You
haven't been in the Hollywood stuff I have been in.
Yeah, I know. I have to work my way up to you. Yeah.
All right, so that was Frankie Manning. We're going to move on to Miss Norma Miller.
Norma, that's the queen right there. And I think you already all know that. She's still around preaching, thank God. And I'm so happy that she's one of the sole survivors, because she's one of the most, even though her memory is not 100%, she's definitely one of the most honest old timers that we'll ever have. I think Norma and Venna are the two that never.
Oh man, yeah.
They don't bullshit you.
Archer?
Yeah.
Yeah.
They're just honest, and it's really nice to hear.
Even Don was like that too. I mean, for the most part, not only the opera, but a swing dancer a little bit, and a performer, but definitely very, very honest. One of her great stories that I feel like is just hilarious, and I have no idea if it was true or not, even to the person she danced with. The first dance she had at Savoy, where she said she was 12 years old, and she was dancing outside of the street, and one of the great Savoy dancers, Twist Mouth George, came up to her, grabbed her off the street, took her into the Savoy, danced this whole crazy ass song, and everybody loved it so much, and then they just threw her back out onto the streets. So that to me is always like, that sounds like Norma. That sounds like a pinnacle moment in her life, being like, well, I gotta make it back in there. And she did eventually.
Yeah, Twistmouth had to get permission. He was a local at the Savoy, mm-hmm. so he was able to get her in the door to show her off. But yeah, and an interesting thing about Norma is also the fact that she really, after the Lindy Hop era, which would be up till, I guess, World War II, we could say, yeah. Frankie obviously tried to start his own dance company for a few years. Norma went on to dance in a few other companies, mm-hmm. And also really embraced just the whole world, I would say, of entertainment.
Yeah.
Especially comedy.
Yeah. Especially towards like the 1970s and 80s,
right.
for sure.
And she did that book with Red Fox. A really good book, you guys, on... It's long out of print, but you can find them on eBay.
Yeah.
It's about...
Amazon.
It's like the black it's the black history of comedy with Red Fox and Norma Miller. Mm-hmm. And she really got into the whole kind of concept of performing from the stage, not just as a Lindy Hopper, but as just an overall performer, which is a different avenue than what Frankie took.
Yeah.
So you really get a good idea if you guys talk to Norma or ever get suckered into one of her trickeration classes, how hard she is on you, and she expects you to dance like the best person of any year, period.
I think she even says it very, very often that she's told that maybe you shouldn't teach. Yes?
Yeah.
And she's like, I agree with that. I don't want to teach. She very, very, like we were saying, honest and blunt sometimes, to a point that she just says she doesn't like teaching beginners. She's like, you go learn the steps, go do all the stuff, then come back to me after a few years, and then I'll teach you my things. And the thing she has to teach you is usually the idea of performing. And just like Peter said a minute ago, it was like later in her life, in the 60s, 70s, and 80s, when she was performing and doing one-woman acts and doing jazz show acts and like just crazy amounts of stuff, and comedy as well with Red Fox, she learned all these ideas from performing the Lindy Hop on stage. That she got these ideas and formed them over time and then refined them even further with other people, the collaboration, which was really, really great. So we're gonna go on to her quote. Oh, before that, sorry. What year did she join the White Lindy Hoppers? I have her written there.
I think it was just a few years after that she went into the Savoy, so it was around 34, 35.
Exactly, yeah.
And she was still too young to technically, legally be able to dance at the Savoy.
Yeah. And even some places that she performed, they would have to lie. They would tell her that she, or they would tell her not to say anything because they didn't want anybody to discover that she was like 17, 16 years old. And they had to be like 19 or 20 to get in these places that they were performing. So.
And one of the neat things about Norma too, as opposed to all the other Whiteys, was obviously you've heard the story about Herbert, Herbert White, the bouncer at the Savoy, who's their boss in charge of them. He would tell them how to dress.
Yeah.
And he, for each particular show they would do, he would tell them how to dress and what to wear. And because they were doing so many air steps, Herbert would ask the girls in the troupe to actually wear flats. And Norma was like, nope, hell no, hell no, I wear what I wear. And so Norma's been always that strong-headed person. And you'll notice that even in Hell's a Poppin', Norma was always gonna wear heels. If you don't tell me what to wear, don't make us look like little girls.
Yeah, there's another reason why like she's so poignant is because in every clip she's in, you see her. Like you see everybody else as like a flash in the pan, and then you see her, like even in that picture that we have up there, she's right there in the middle, and like you see her. She has a presence.
Yeah.
Even today, when you see on the other picture on the right, she still has a presence on stage.
I mean, even today when we do Shorty Georges, we have Shorty Normas.
Yeah, exactly.
What follower has a shorty after them? Only Norma.
Maybe Elsa.
Is there?
She's short.
Okay.
but yeah. So.
Novice George.
Novice George. Oh God. Anyways, so with that, when she joined the Whiteys and the Hoppers in 1934, the reason why she joined was because she won a contest at the Apollo Theater against a bunch of other already established Whiteys Lindy Hoppers. And so right after she won that contest with her partner, Whitey came up to her and said, I'd rather you dance with us than against us. And that's something that's really amazing. He knew right away, instead of going mocking her and being like, oh no, my dancers are the best, and you only won because of a fluke. It's like, oh, actually, you're really good. You should come with us and do this really good thing on stage with us. So I think that's, for me, my point of view, when I see something like that, I see somebody that has the ability to see and acknowledge good talent and help foster it. And I think that's something that can go further than just being a dancer, going further than just being a teacher, going further than just being any kind of judge that we have today in today's scene, is to acknowledge somebody's doing really, really good and help foster that, as opposed to just telling, hey, good job, and then walk away. It's like, say, hey, good job. Like, what's the reason behind it? Why did you do it like this? You know, ask questions, give your point of view. I think that's really, really important in our today's Lindy Hop community.
Otherwise, they'll join the other dance troupe and
beat us.
Right. At that time, going back in that time, at the Savoy, it was a absolute battle. And the king of the Savoy was absolutely Shorty George and his dancers. But that changed when Shorty George had a falling out with the Savoy people, and so he started to go train at Small's Paradise. But there was still this intense rivalry between obviously the Savoy dancers, which became Herbert White's dancers, versus the Shorty George dancers. So there's always a rivalry, and I think people need to understand it was that rivalry that was what propelled the dance forward, trying to be inventors, trying to outdo one another. And that was the incubator of the Lindy Hop itself. And it's very vital at that point in its birthing years for this one upmanship to happen. And that's what made this dancer better than the next one and the next one. And this was a daily or even weekly battle, which was absolutely friendly, but what it did was it benefited the dance.
Yeah.
And that's something that we should think about a little bit, because we don't have that today. Today, the competitions are strictly about, you know, trophies and awards, but is it
and YouTube views,
and of course YouTube video views, but is it propelling the dance forward or not? And that's one of the interesting, I think that's a very interesting topic, because Frankie Manning didn't like contests for the last 20-30 years of his life. He was totally against contests all through the 80s, 90s, and early 2000s. And I never understood why. Why don't you like contests? You were in contests, yeah. You know. He's the guy in the brown suit, which you don't even see because he's wearing brown. Meanwhile, Al Mims is in an all-white belt back, taking all the credit.
Yeah.
And I think it had to do, and this is my own, knowing Frankie so well, I think what it came down to was the fact that dance contests today, when I say today, I actually mean when Frankie was alive, in mid-2000s, the dance contests today do not propel the dance forward anymore. Now it's the same stuff over and over and over. And so Frankie said, he doesn't like contests as he once did. And I think it had something to do with the fact that the contests today don't help the dance as it used to help the dance. And by helping the dance, I mean propelling it to something new.
Yeah,
Today it slowed down. Like, when do you see a new air step? When do you see a new swing out?
As you're saying this stuff, like, I really do, I see it in a different light. I almost want to take it a step further and take it into kind of like a more selfish point of view, where it's like, I don't think I should propel the dance forward. I feel like I should propel my own dancing forward. And I don't care about what this other guy is doing. Maybe it's cool, maybe it's not. Don't care, because I'm gonna make sure my moves and my things that I'm doing with me and my partner are gonna be the best that we can possibly do it, and feel like they're the best and have that confidence being up there. You know, as you were saying, like, all that stuff, like how it was back in the day. Like, remember the late 90s, early 2000s in LA? There used to be contests every night of the week, or every like Friday, Saturday, Sunday. And there was some people like Adam Velez, remember him, like way back then? He was a dancer in LA, and he for a while, for like a good year, he would go to all these contests and win them all, and then come back to memories after the end of the night. So on Saturday he would go to a contest and win, and then he'd come back to memories, and then Sunday he would go to a contest and win and come back to memories. And so it was always that thing, it's like, well, drinks are on Adam. every weekend, it was amazing. And I haven't thought of that in a long time. And that helped propel a lot of the LA dancers forward. Not just doing just Hollywood style stuff, but like eventually just kind of going out there and being like, you know what? F this, I'm just gonna dance however fast, which is really, really fast. We were dancing really fast back then, and however I want to make sure this dance just keeps going.
Right, and I think that's exactly how the old timers thought.
Yeah.
The same as you.
Yeah.
I'm only care about myself and my partner and doing something that represents us. It's the judge's fault, not the dancer's. It's not the dancer's
it's
fault.
The damn judges.
No, it's never the dancers are just doing what they do.
Yeah.
It's always gonna be whoever's judging and guiding the train, which tracks to take is what's gonna guide. And yeah, and LA was absolutely like that. But there was good money involved as well.
Yeah.
Every contest.
Yeah.
Back when you can dance for $1,000 contest, you're gonna actually dance against competitors.
Yep.
People that are here to win, and they come from salsa, they come from rockabilly, they come from Lindy, they come from when there's $1,000 contest, you'd be surprised who shows up. And you're like, I never met you before. Who are you?
Let's
I'm a salsa dancer. Yeah. Oh, okay.
Let's admit it. Like, money is a great motivator.
Money motivated.
And there's
all
nothing.
Of us.
I feel like me and Peter are on point with this. By saying there's nothing wrong with having a good, healthy competition with just you and money.
Absolutely.
You know, like, you want to have that money keeps walking away from you. You keep running after it with good dancing.
And the thing is this, we would be dancing in these contests in live bands, and I swear you guys, these live bands, when they play a song, it could be, 7 minutes, 8 minutes,
yeah.
It could be sing, 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 and all of a sudden you realize, from listening to these old timers and listening to their stories, you're like, I'm getting tired, wait a minute, let's do slow motion,
yeah.
And you start doing slow motion. And we're talking about an all skate of 50 couples. How do you get seen in an all skate of 50 couples?
By doing the opposite, going
slow. Doing the opposite, or doing the itch, or doing the Dutchman, or I can tell we can go on and on about the contest tricks that the old timers did, but all of these moves became something that makes sense to the culture in which they danced at. Today,
yeah, absolutely.
When we were in a contest, we got a 78, 3 minutes. Woo! If you do slow motion during that 3 minutes, you're dumb. You're not a very smart competitor. Or the itch. Like, when was the last time you judged a contest? The itch. Oh, mark him up. That was a good one. Very well done. Good display of craftsmanship. Like, there's no purpose to that move.
Yeah.
That move was done for a reason in competitions in the 30s and 40s. And today they're just like little jazz steps that we can stick in there when we don't know what to do.
Yeah. At some point we all have to take responsibility for our own dancing and kind of like stop thinking about a status quo. When it comes to that point where you are on stage or in front of people dancing and you want to get that prize, make sure you're doing the best and you're making sense while you're doing it.
And that's also, that has to do with the fact that today there's a lot of contests that everybody does that are addressed specifically, Lindy Hop contest. But there's plenty of events out there that don't specify.
Exactly.
Just swing contests.
Exactly.
Where, what is Lindy Hop? What isn't Lindy Hop? You know, and that's a barrier that we all have to just live through. There's no answers there, you guys. Sorry.
And in speaking of all this kind of like feeling of going further with performance and contest stuff, the second quote for Norma is, the audience relates to you because you are entertaining them. A little bit of advice, I'll pass it on to you. When I watch you, some of you suck.
That's normal.
That's normal.
And she's just so freaking honest.
Yeah.
And I can't say enough. When I look at contests, I will just put this out there, and then you can take it however you want. I actually, sometimes when I'm watching a contest, I want to walk down onto the floor, and I want to address a person, and I want to say, do you really think you have an opportunity to win this contest?
Right in the middle
because
of the contest,
why
right?
Why are you in it?
He's right in the middle of the contest, right?
Wasting all of our time.
Big time. I want to do that so much.
I don't understand it. And I do understand the modern philosophy of everybody gets a participation trophy. How fun is that? But it doesn't make our dance.
I
want
to be in
good.
This contest. We were talking about this earlier. He said that, and I was like, I want to be in this contest. I want to get a trophy for every time I do a contest. I can't remember the last time I won a contest.
And then you have some professional salsa dancer like Google Lindy Hop on YouTube, and here comes the contest. And it's like, what? Is this what this scene is about? Because this is horrible. And I think we all have to take a little bit of responsibility when we step on the floor that at least you're trying to win. As long as you're trying to win, it's okay. It could be your first day dancing. I don't care. You're trying to win. But when I see people go out on the floor and just trying to rely on their regular old social dancing in a contest format, it doesn't do anything for me. And that's why Norma's quote is so valuable. Yeah. It's somebody has to say you suck. And it's not cool if any young person does it, but when a 90-year-old does it from the Savoy, it carries some weight.
Yeah, seriously.
And when Norma dies, I am going to be so sad.
And even with this, when she says, like, some of you suck and everything, like, yeah, all that stuff, I actually agree with you for the most part. There's a couple, one or two things I don't agree with, but that's fine. The one thing I feel when she says that is that I have to be ready to go up in front of people and understand that, yeah, everybody's on my side. Everybody wants me to dance well or wants all of us to dance well, but some of us aren't going to like some of the things that we see up there, and that's okay. That's totally okay. To have your own opinion will make you stronger and more confident as a person, but opinions change over time. Opinions change greatly over time. If you watch one of our old clips from 1998, you'll see for the most part that we've changed. He probably hasn't, he still looks the exact same. I was just a little bit shorter.
But that's different than opinion.
Yeah, I know, right. Yeah, looks are different, yeah.
Right. No, just about normal.
No, but I mean, yes, but I choose to see it in multiple different points of view. When she says some of you suck, she really means it, like, wow, why are you doing with, like, what you said? Like, if she had the energy to, like, stop a contest and be like, did you really mean that thing you just did? Because that was horrible. I'm going to make you do it all over again with the band. But I think for me is also understanding that I'm not going to please everybody all the time. So again, I'm not thinking about my competitors, even though I want to beat them. I'm not thinking about the audience, even though I want to entertain you. I'm thinking about what I have to be doing for me, my partner, and what we can be doing to this music, which is beyond just social dancing. It's like really being in tune with your own dancing, being able to pull out crazy ass shit when you're ready to.
But Norma, she wants to see the full package. She wants to see swing outs. She wants to see air steps.
That's very
true. She wants to see side by side routines. She wants to see it all. This is what defines the Lindy Hop.
Very much.
To Norma Miller, who's obviously part of the second generation of dancers. And basically, anybody after Norma's generation didn't do Lindy Hop. That's Norma. You know, anybody after her, the World War II and earlier people, you know,
like we're gonna talk about, like, George and Sutton.
Right. That's not Lindy Hop.
Yeah. Norma, right? Yeah. Exactly.
That's the next generation of people.
The funny thing is, every generation of Lindy Hopper will always go look back and go, yeah, that was it. And they look forward and they're like, no, that's not it at all. Every generation you talk to, not even for dancing, just old people in general, just be like, that's horrible.
Every generation is in competition with the previous generation.
Or the next.
But Lindy Hop's a little bit different. After the second generation, as you guys already know, the Lindy Hop actually didn't technically exist in its pop culture terminology as it did previously.
Right.
In 49, it changed to Jitterbug Dive or whatever.
Yeah.
But Lindy Hop is a very specific thing, and Norma is one of the people that we should really think about as a foundation. And if any of you ever get a chance to just talk to her for just a couple minutes on the side at an event or something, have your questions ready and really get that picture, because
and really get ready for what she's gonna say.
She's for real.
Yeah.
I can't say enough about Norma.
There's a really really great clip of her discussion with Bobby White from I want to say 3 or 4 years ago now. At Beantown, and it's an hour, maybe an hour and a half of her just talking about clips. So she's talking about other dancers and why they were doing what they were doing, her personal experiences with them, and then her own philosophy behind the dance and especially performing. When Peter just said a minute ago of it, for her it's about the swing out. You know that last swing out before, like in big dance contests. You know, everybody did their spotlight, and then now they all wait, and then, you know, you hear that crescendo, you hear that phrase coming up, and then everybody just swings out toward the crowd. You know that feeling you get when you watch it? That's what she wants. She wants that all the time, though. Not just at that one moment. She wants that every time you go out there. In that interview, she talks about being like, when you swing out, you're swinging out from the wing of the stage and going all the way to the center. So it's when you think about that, it's not just a swing out that just stays in one place. It's a swing out that fucking moves, you know, books it from that part of the stage to where we are in one swing out, you know? So for me, like, that is it. She's not looking for the craziest moves. She's looking for you to do the move correctly and perfect it to your knowledge. So I think that's very powerful in itself. So we're not gonna do that last quote, but even though that last quote is just nice, it's just nice cheese. She just talks about Lindy Hop, and that's this. All these three quotes are actually in that interview. So if you wanna watch that, I very much encourage you to watch that.
And buy her book.
Oh yeah, and buy her book. Absolutely, yeah, yeah. So the clip we're gonna show is of her dancing in a famous dance clip. I think you guys will know. I mean, just start playing it, and then she's like a couple.
Do we have the name of the musicians?
Watched it 10,000 times already yet. That clip is really, really amazing, especially after you see this interview and you hear her speak about a lot of different things. And you can see it in her dancing. Like, she's, for me, it's not the most perfect that I've ever seen her dance. Like, I've seen her dance better in, like, Day at the Races, which is before this. But the thing is, in this clip, there's just so much energy. And for how many times they did it, I imagine that she did it that much, that amount of energy every time, and I know I can't do that every time for as many times as they did it.
One of the interesting things I wanted to state about that, like you just said,
go for it.
It was so many takes they did on that scene, but as Norma talks about a little bit in her book and so forth, and what Whitey's was all about was the dance started as we call it an 8-count dance today, and it was all floor craft. And of course, you all know when that started, when Lindbergh hopped over the Atlantic or shortly thereafter.
Or did it?
Or did it? Or did he? Did the man really walk on the moon? The thing is by 1938, these dancers had invented or created what they called mutiny. And what mutiny is what you see in Hell's a Poppin', where they do air step after air step after air step, back to back to back to back to back. And there is no more, basics, or if you want to even call it that at that point. You might see a swing out or two at the most, but it's a very, very short time in which the dance actually went from one thing to a completely different thing in such a short amount, in less than 10 years. And then, of course, I said 38 was mutiny, and then comes 39, we have the World's Fair, and also we have the tour to Australia. And of course, at that time, it was very interesting as far as research goes, because it shows you that there's nowhere else to go. They've gone to the limits, nowhere else. So where do we go now? Well, we can dress one troop up like clowns and send them to Australia and call them the Big Apple Dancers. And then we can send another troop to the World's Fair in New York and we can have them do other dances. Why don't we start with African? And start there, and then we can go to the cakewalk, and then we can go to early jazz solo dancing, and we can go to Charleston dancing. And so for the first time, you actually have Savoy Lindy Hoppers performing the history of African dance or African-American dance. So it's very interesting when you put the puzzle pieces together. And then, of course, here comes 41, when Hell's a Poppin' was filmed, actually late 40, came out in 41. The same year that Lindy Hop at the Harvest Moon Ball, which was obviously a huge competition in New York, they changed the name to Jitterbug and Jive, which would be more encompassing than the older Lindy Hop term, which is a very specific dance form. And so I think Hills of Hop is really nice because you see the ace team, the best of all of Whitey's dancers dancing together. And they were not, and P.S., it was not called Whitey's Lindy Hoppers and Hells of Poppin'. They were called the Kangaroo Dancers. Lindy Hop was a passé term at that time, and so they changed. And the new term of the early 40s, 41, 42, was Conga, Kangaroos, Conga Line, anything like that was very, very popular. And we see that with even Jewel McGowan.
And even the drums at the beginning of that clip.
Right. Yeah, and very interesting. J.J. Johnson on drums mm-hmm. and so forth.
So we're going to move on to the next old-timer. A person that you've heard us talk about many a time. His name is Hal Takier, or Hal Savoy.
Yeah, Shabor. He was an Armenian immigrant in California. And so, yeah, his name was actually Shavor, C-H-V-O-O-R, something like that. So he got nicknamed Hal Savoy. By the 30s dancers. Mm-hmm.
Because by that point, everybody had heard about the Savoy. If you were a swing dancer or a jazz musician lover, you heard of the Savoy.
Hal Takier and his wife Marge was probably the most influential old-timers for all of the LA dancers.
Definitely. I mean, because of the whole thing we talked about earlier, because we had contests almost every weekend in the late 90s and early 2000s, is because of him. Is because he was talking about his stories about going to weekends and going to different contests and winning them. And going so much to the point where like he would show up to a place and people would drop out because they're just like, well, we're not going to win because he's here now. Yeah? And that's him and his first dance partner, Betty.
Yeah, basically Hal's parents said, if you want a new shirt, shoes, or pants, you need to go get yourself a job. We're not going to buy it for you. Mm-hmm. So Hal started to compete at these competitions starting in 1935, and he was looking for money. He didn't want plastic trophies.
But even before that, when he was living with his extended family, his cousins were telling him, you have to learn how to dance in high school. So this is probably between the ages of 13 to 17 years old in Southern California. They're like, you have to learn how to dance. Like, you're already moving to this music, so you might as well learn to dance. And he started to do that at high school at lunchtime, because at lunchtime there would be this radio program, and they would play only swing music. Only swing, jazz, big band music. And it was like the hot stuff. Like, the things we take for granted nowadays, we're like, maybe that's a little too fast. They were like, that's what we want to dance to. So he's talking about like how... In another famous clip that we don't have here, but you can see, is the beach clip, where basically kids are just dancing on the sidewalk on the beach. Is like he's saying that like that's what they used to do in high school at lunchtime. So he would start learning from that, and then he would start going to it's a random place in LA where he paid 15 cents. They gave him a donut and a coffee, and they played music all night long.
Right, he's from Redondo Beach, where I'm from. And the high school that he went to, I used to sell weed there. So I know the high school very well. And there used to be a ballroom right on the beach at Horseshoe Pier where I used to surf. And
Peter's done it all, you guys. He's seriously like, ask him a question. Did you ever do this? Oh, yeah, 1978 for sure.
Well, that was one of the biggest and most important things in the history for myself was how many of you have seen the Ken Burns jazz film documentary? It's like a 10 DVD set. It's huge, right? And it starts in New Orleans, goes to Chicago, goes to New York. That's the end of the history. And then here I am looking at this guy who's 95 years old, who was dancing in Los Angeles, and who invented the Shim Sham. And I'm thinking, wait a minute. That's not the history of the jazz dance that I know, because here's a guy right here named Leonard Reed. And so my point is my neighborhood was just as valid as any other neighborhood. You just have to go look for it.
Yeah.
And Hal Takier popped up. And I was like, wait a minute, there used to be a ballroom right there where I surfed? You gotta be kidding me. And you went to what high school? Oh my God, yes, I know where it is, behind the library. We all used to hang out there. You know. So you have this bond that you wouldn't normally have, and that's an in when you talk about the old timers.
Yeah.
When you see a group of old timers talking about the ballrooms and the dances, and they don't remember shit because they're old, and then you're sitting there right there with an earshot going, oh yeah, that was Anza Avenue and right there the cross street was Prospect. And they go, yeah, that's right. And then they talk, wait a minute, how do you know? The streets don't change the names, you know. And so that's an in to be friends with a lot of these people. And
for me, it's the same thing. It's because in his later life, he moved in a mile away from my house.
Yep.
And I had no idea until I started meeting him in the late 90s, like 99, 2000.
Now he lives in a rich neighborhood.
I mean, sorta. Like, yeah, it was the old people rich neighborhood.
Right.
It was called Leisure World.
And the thing about it was
called Leisure World. It had a big globe in front of it, yeah. And he lived in the nice part of it. Yeah.
He wasn't the only one that lived there, but yeah.
Yeah. Oh, I know.
And the thing about Hal that's so cool was number one, the money drive. He needed the money because he was poor.
Yeah.
So he was out to win contests. Number one. Number two. He would go to the Fox Theater on Pier Avenue in Hermosa Beach, and he would watch Day of the Races. African-American dancers from East Coast. And he would watch the whole film until the dancing sequence, and then he would take notes as fast as he can. And then they would sit there and wait for the movie to play again.
Because it was a matinee, right?
There was no pause, rewind. Yeah. You had to wait, and he would take notes, and he would go home and practice. And he came up with his own swing out from Day at the Races that looks nothing like what they do at Day at the Races. So that's one thing about how that's so cool, we can say positively.
Absolutely.
And then also, his technique to winning contests was so vital to all of us in LA. He had a list of paper that Marge has to this day of 20 different moves that he would do. He had 5 different entrances, 5 different exits. And they would, so that's 30 altogether. He would practice all of those every day, he claims.
Yeah.
And then
he would, I mean, to be fair, when I look at him, and he's like 89, and he's
he would show up at the contest. He would say, we're doing that entrance, that exit, and he would pick 3 moves.
Yep.
And that's how he would do all of his competitions.
Yep.
It's so valuable, you guys. If you lived in the atmosphere we did in Los Angeles in the 90s, where you have the same 10 couples always going for the same $1,000. That was the most helpful tidbit of advice for competing from Hal that I've ever heard.
Write your shit down.
Write your shit down and practice your moves over and over and over again.
It's so true. Like all that stuff right there, a lot of the ideas that me and Peter talk about came a lot from Hal and our experiences with his friends and his old-time friends, basically, that were his childhood friends dancing with him. And two of them is exactly that, watching the clips and taking notes. We did that endlessly. And then the same thing is like writing stuff down and not being afraid to just call it out in a dance contest with your partner. That those are two things that are just so vital. And it's not to say that we don't do it today, but we're saying like, if you're thinking about doing that, yes, then do it, for sure. Don't feel like you're a nerd. We're all nerds, so we're good, yeah? So let's just do it all together. Let's try to win this. So the quote that we want to move on to, before I move on to the quote, because you did hit on it just a second ago, is that to us, we considered him one of the best dancers in Southern California. And then when you talk to the other old timers, they would consider him the best. Like we said before, other dancers would drop out of contest just because he was already in it. So they're like, forget it. Don't even have a chance. So when we talk about him, we talk about him with admiration for the dance, but also as a person, he was the nicest person. He was always smiling. Like that smile, that's him all the time.
Yeah, that's Hal.
That's Hal.
That's his first wife, Betty. And of course you can see that's Ginger Rogers, who was quite a dancer. That's really misleading. It says Harvest Moon Ball first. Yes, it was. Every major city in America had a Harvest Moon Ball.
It was a very common term.
That's a time of the year. You already know that.
It's like how we use a lot of like Lindy Hop contests. I'll call Hell's a Poppin' contests. There's not just one. There's many of them.
But this is at the Olympic Auditorium in Los Angeles, which became famous for boxing matches.
Yeah.
And the thing that he said about how that's so vital is he pushed the hell out of all of us. He never bragged, ever. The only time I ever heard Hal brag was when Maxie Dorff was talking shit to a group of old-timers, talking about how he won everything, and then him and Willie Desitov started to argue. You never did, and Hal was just standing there smiling the whole time. He didn't say nothing the whole time. And then finally, at the very end, he goes, they never beat me. And they both shut up. Willie and Maxie, they just were like, boom.
Yeah.
Because you never beat me.
Yeah.
And the thing that Hal was so cool was even in the 80s when he was a senior, there is a brand in the States, Geritol, a senior citizens thing. And they did this American championships where they went around from city to city doing these senior citizens competitions and jitterbugging. And then they flied all the old timers to New York for the finals. And as you can imagine, every old timer, they brought their music up to what they're gonna dance to. And you can imagine it was Tuxedo Junction and you know, these kinds of songs. And then here comes Hal and Marge, and it's Traffic Jam. You know, dun 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 dun, and they're dancing furiously fast, which is not possible in a Geritol competition, except for Hal and Marge.
That's a different one from this one, right? It's not this one.
No. And so, my point is Hal was a competitor his whole life, all the way to the end, and he still won. I think there's nobody can take credit for his winning as many contests as Hal Takier and Marge or Betty.
Yeah,
and Marge, that's for truth.
Marge, his widow right now, who still lives in the same place about a mile away from my place in Orange County, she has a huge book, and I mean like a photo book, but like this big, full of all the newspaper clippings of all the contests they used to go to, all the ballrooms they used to go to. When someone won a contest back then, they published it in the newspaper. You know, like that was their Facebook feed. Yeah, they were like, "Boom, we won!" Yeah, that, and she clipped it out, and there it was. And then after winning all this stuff, especially in LA, you would get these people like Ginger Rogers that were Hollywood movie stars, and they would be presenting prizes, and there would be people of importance in the Hollywood industry judging. And on top of that, seeing like, "Oh, there's this talented person that can dance. Let's put him in a movie." You know, let's just put him in the background, and or like let's like film him for a little bit. So this is why we have so many. I mean, besides maybe them being white, is that we have the reason why we have so many of these dancers on film, and we're able to watch it over and over again and study it as much as we have. To go along with what you just said, like how encouraging, how like just humble he was, but he also was pushing. And he wanted to push all the rest of us dancers that were coming up and like seeing him as an idol. He wanted to push us. So one way he did it was by, you ever had a coach on the sidelines and like go, go and do it, go, go, yeah. Imagine if that coach just went, boom.
That was how.
And he would just be sitting on the side at Bob McGee's. And Bob McGee's was like a sunken dance floor. So it was like up here and then down there. That's where it was. So he'd be sitting on the edge. And there'd be just these chairs. You'd just be sitting like this. Boom! It would scare the shit out of you, but at first you're like, oh. I mean, he would do that when he's like, oh, that was good. I like that. Oh, yeah. So he just went, boom! Every time.
He also used to say commonly, he would sit down and he'd see you step on the floor with somebody and he would say, show me something.
Yeah.
Like all the time, show me something. In the middle of a dance, show me. You could be social dancing with somebody you're in love with.
Yeah.
And then here's Hal, show me something. And you're like, fuck, all right. You know. But that was Hal.
That was Hal.
He pushed your ass. And the only reason he stopped doing slip outs and drops and free spins was because his wife, Marge, she was worried that if he ever broke a bone, that he would take forever to heal,
exactly,
which is
smart. Smart, yeah.
But Hal was, he was 80 plus going on 16 his whole life. And I can't say enough about it. He would get in every jam. As soon as a song came on with the tempo, he was looking for the jam session, or he's going to start the jam session.
Yeah.
And he would make us look really stupid.
Yeah.
Man.
He would do big time.
You know, swing outs, the side-by-side routines with his wife, the slip outs and the drops and he did it all in his 80s, and he just made us look stupid.
He probably would have kept doing the merry-go-round if it wasn't for Marge being like, no, not for that.
Absolutely.
The merry-go-round is that move where they like stand side by side. He pulls her towards her like a jump. She lands on his leg into a dip, and she's clinched onto his leg, and then he just twirls her around on one leg. That's called the merry-go-round. That's what he called it. The other thing on that is, He was so humble. He never was like, oh, don't ask me about anything. I'm not going to teach you anything. If you went up to him and be like, hey, how'd you do that move over there? And he'd be like, well, okay, let's figure it out. And he'd go out on the dance floor with you and grab somebody and show you how to do it. So I have a very fond memory. And I'm actually talking to the mom of my first dance partner, because she filmed Hal
teaching me and my dance partner how to do the merry-go-round. And he's like pulling my dance partner, who was probably 15 or 14 years old at the time. And we were both 15 or 14 years old at the time. He's pulling her, and she's surprised. She's like, he's so strong. And I was like, yeah. That's not that old man strength. That is just strength, yeah. And so so that was one of my fond memories. It's like, that was like the first or second time I met him too. And as in like the first time, maybe it was by passing, like, hello, I'm a dancer, hello, nice to meet you. Okay, that's it. Second time, how'd you do that move you did so famously so many times? Well, let me show you. You know, that was him. So we're gonna go into the first clip, the clip for him. We lovingly call it the white pants clip. I saw it really early, and I, before I even met Hal, and I was like, I don't know what I just watched, but I know it's good. and it wasn't until recently, like in the past year, that I rewatched it, and I was like, oh, that's Jumpin' at Woodside. Like, that was the jam. Like, I think when I hear Jumpin' at Woodside, I think Swing Out, and when I saw that, I was like, oh, that's so amazing. That's so cool. Whole nother perspective, whole nother way. In that clip, Peter, real quick, that clip, that's Kenny Wetzel, Dean the MC, right? Kenny Wetzel, for those guys out there that love the St. Louis Shag, one of the proponents for it, one of the better dancers of it, exciting dancers of the St. Louis Shag. He was very, very big in the swing dance scene a lot all over the country, even to the point where he was emceeing for, he was the biggest MC around, so they got him to do the emceeing for the US Open, which is for West Coast Swing.
Yeah, when you see those 80s, and they didn't even call it West Coast Swing in the early days.
No, not really.
In the U.S. Open. It was this U.S. Open Swing Dance Championships.
Yeah.
And you saw some dancers that looked like, you know, the Westy thing. And then you saw some dancers that almost looked Lindy, but it's not Lindy either. And you saw these two different things in the 80s be born.
Yeah.
But that's Kenny Wetzel. And so any of those dance clips you look at, it doesn't matter who, but when you hear an MC in the background, in the middle of a performance.
Yeah.
It's probably Kenny.
He couldn't keep his mouth shut up. Yeah.
Yeah.
The other thing about that clip is that that's one part of like an hour long. Do you know what it's for?
That's Rebel Swing Dance Club, which is Kenny's, if I'm not mistaken.
And it was like a showcase. So they had a bunch of like couples come out there and dance with this band. And when you watch all the other ones, they're like dancing to like mid tempo, maybe a little bit higher. And then Hal and Marge get out there, and they're like, what song do you want to dance to? And Marge just gets out in front and just goes, and the band starts playing. So if you watch it again, you see Marge just tapping out the rhythm, and the band goes, okay, that's cool, we can do that.
Yeah, LA Swing Club, they would do that normally. There was a once a month dance, and they always loved to feature dancers. So at some point in the evening, Kenny would announce some special dancers, and that's who he would bring out. So it might be, it could be Dean Collins and Mary, it could be Hal, it could be any of those dancers, and they all dance so different from one another. They're all, none of them were looked the same. None of them were doing the same dance. I don't know what you guys would say that dance is. Hal would just call it swing. And if you would try to get more information from him, he would just smile and say, it's just swing. Don't try to put any labels on it. It's not. He was not a Balboa dancer. He never was a Balboa dancer. He started off as a kid in Redondo Beach as what they call jig trot dancing, which is basically body to body and move your feet as fast as possible. That's really the only definition you can say. And
I think he probably picked up some bow moves, but he never saw it as bow. He just saw it as a cool move he wanted to put
all,
in his dancing.
They all ended up doing Balboa in their old age together.
Yeah, but I'm talking about when they were kids.
But when they're kids, no. There was an absolute divide between the dances. And he was a jig trot dancer that went into swing dancing or incorporated the swing moves into his jig trot. You've heard the name Lawrence Lolly Wise, and you've heard the name Maxie Dorff and Willie Desitoff. Everybody came from different areas of Los Angeles, and they all started with completely different dances, so they all have completely different basics. Today in the bow swing scene, we tend to learn Maxie Dorff's style.
I mean, another way to think about this too, like when you put it that way in the sense of like LA and these people going from the outlying cities, when you go back and watch Harvest Moonball clips, so like the big center stage in Madison Square Garden, and then a bunch of different couples from all over New York, right? Watch them, watch somebody else who you don't usually watch, and you can see the difference of the dance styles. From, let's say, just someone in general, someone from the Savoy to someone in Alhambra Ballroom to Roseland Ballroom to Smalls Ballroom. You wouldn't know exactly because, I mean, for me, I wouldn't know exactly which one came from which, but you can see that, oh, okay, this is how they kind of danced a little bit differently in each ballroom. And then within each ballroom, each dancer danced a little bit different from that as well.
Sort of, yeah. I would say that's true. Except even more magnified to where it's not even the same dances anymore.
Oh, yes, yeah. Okay, I hear you. Yeah. I'm just saying it in a different way.
In L.A., Hal said he learned Dean's Lindy so he could social dance with other girls.
Yeah.
Because what he did was so original and so different to the next generation.
Yeah, and that's a really good segue to the next old time we're going to talk about. Exactly, because this is another person that learned Dean's Lindy, which was Jean Veloz.
And everybody knows Jean Veloz, right?
My childhood crush when I was 14 years old watching Swing Fever going, who's the cute blonde?
You're a slut.
Oh yeah, still am.
As you guys know, Jeannie's around. She's been in the last couple of years, she's been in some really wonderful videos. One with you, actually, Dancing With You, which I applaud you for.
Thank you.
You did an amazing job of, it's really, really hard to dance with somebody that old, 95.
When you don't want to be the person dancing with them and all of a sudden they break. You don't want to be that guy.
You don't want to be that guy, right. And at the same time, you know exactly how good they were.
And if you go
back half a century.
Yeah, and still are, but for whatever physical ailments they might have at the moment, they just can't fully express it, but it's still there. And when I'm on the other end of her hand, I'm following her.
That's what
I'm in her world. It's so ingrained inside every little part of her DNA strand that when you get a chance to see her or watch her or even awesomely dance with her, you're going to feel it. You have to jump into their world.
But you're one of the very, very few people that can understand that. I think most people, they grab Jeannie Veloz and they're like, oh, remember you in this movie? Yeah. And I'm going to do this with you. And you're like, whoa, dude, that was 65 years ago. Dude, you can't be doing that with her anymore. I've seen people, and I'm like, wow, you're an idiot. Because you're going to be that dude.
Yeah.
That dude that you just spoke
of. Don't want to be that dude. Right. Don't want to be that dude. But so, and this is why, again, a lot of these old, like you said before, a lot of these old timers here, is we pick them because we have personal interactions with them. And only till recently I've had personal interactions with Jean Veloz, being able to teach with her, being able to perform with her, and that was amazing. And it's I'm definitely humble brag, like, got to teach with her. Oh, it was awesome. But everything made sense, and she would accredit Dean for a lot of these ideas and the way that that she danced the Lindy Hop now. But then she would just be like, well, can't explain what it is. And then she starts moving her shoulders, and then she's just like, puts out her hand, and I'm like, okay, she wants to dance with me. And then when I dance with her, you can see what she means, is in the sense of, it's not a move. It's a feeling from the music, and she's translating it through a move. Does that make sense? It's the other way of thinking it. As opposed to learning numbers to movements in your body and then try to fit it into music, she hears the music and then just makes it up as it happens. So she never really had a chance to be like, okay, well, this is what I'm doing, up until recently when her helper, Rusty Frank, is helping her try to figure out what these moves are and putting names to them so that way it could be saved for time.
Right, and it's important to say right now that what we're talking about is not Lindy Hop at all. What the LA dancers did was the Lindy,
yeah,
not the Lindy Hop. Every single LA dancer was damn fucking clear about the fact that they did not do that shit back east.
No.
That's a fucking showboat gymnastic stuff. What we do is dancing. That's what they would have said.
That's what Dean said.
No, not Dean.
Dean said it in an interview. Not like how you said it, but he said it in an interview. Yeah. And that's a whole other thing.
No, all the LA dancers that I met were very, very animate about the fact that they did not do the Lindy Hop. They did a dance that comes from the Lindy Hop. And what they did is more, they would say it's, first off, it's more socially friendly, number one. And number two, what they do shows off the girls. They wouldn't say followers. They said the girls or the ladies. And so Lindy is a very, very different dance than the Lindy Hop. As much as today tries to meld them together, we do quite successfully. But we don't see these extreme styles anymore.
Yeah.
Because if you want to be Jean Veloz, you need to be Arthur Walsh. You need to be Dean Collins. And the to for the follower to do that style.
Yeah.
It takes two people. It takes two people. And if you don't both have it, you're never going to get it.
It's very true. And it's such a funny thing because like I feel like when, from her, like what you just said is so true. It's not just a personal thing. It takes two people to have this personal idea for the Lindy, the LA Lindy, to actually happen. And it's perfectly able to be seen in the send out. As in like, you're in closed position, then you send your partner out. And Jean was so funny with me last time we talked because she was like, she's like, no, push me, no, harder, no, keep going, no, that would keep going. She just made me do it like 10 times in front of a huge class, by the way. And I had to just be like, I just had to sit there and take it because I was like, I am your helper, you are the master here, and I am just trying to learn what you're doing. So finally I was like, I did it right. And she's like, ooh, there it is. I was like, oh. I never felt so good about anything in my life. But there is a clear difference from what I was doing before and what she was asking me to do. And granted, of course, that she couldn't put it into words exactly for it to make sense for me immediately, I had to feel it so many different times. And again, it takes those two people to make that feeling happen. With Jean Veloz, like, she started as a child, her mother put her in ballet and tap as per the norm usually back then. And then they moved into Hollywood in her early teenage years. And she started going up dances, and that's where she learned to see Dean's Lindy and started to learn Dean's Lindy because, again, just like Peter said, it was more social and everyone was doing it. So she was like, I want to do it too. I want to go hang out with kids and dance with boys and hang out with girls and everything. And so she started learning all that stuff, and she got a partner, her little baby brother, Ray Phelps. And together they would go out and do dance contests and come up with routines very similar to how we talked about Hal. It was very just commonplace to like get ready for stuff. If you're gonna go out there and you're gonna perform something, you better like roll up the rug and go into go into the living room, roll up the rug and get practicing, right? And for her, that's when she accredited all of her feelings, like she just felt the music. So in her quote, she would say, I said it's the magic, that what happens, and then I said, just listen, and then react, and let it fill your being, soul, or whatever. And oh, magical things can happen. And it's so true, because it's so funny, because I think for me, a lot of the old timers just really love like Benny Goodman and Count Basie, and those were her two favorite bands back in the day. She said she loved Benny Goodman, but then when she heard Count Basie, she was like, it blew him out of the water. And then when we danced the other day, she was like, I don't know, put something on. And I mistakenly put on a Sam Cooke song, and she just goes, oh yeah, let's dance to that. And her shoulders start going, and she's just like feeling it. You can see her fade away from all of this reality and move into her own world, where it's all about movement and self-expression to music. And it was amazing. I was like, are you sure? It's like the first song I played. It's like, yeah, let's just do that one. I was like, okay. And we danced to it, and she just comes alive. It's the most amazing thing ever. So with music in general, I think for us, or at least for me, sorry, I didn't mean to speak for you, but for me, I didn't grow up listening to jazz music. I listened to a lot of rock, a lot of 80s hair rock, a lot of hip-hop, R&B, and country for some reason. My dad was really into country, but not jazz. So back then, when you think about all these old-timers, they grew up with it around them. It was around them all the time. Like water is so plentiful now as today, it was jazz music. So like it's so ingrained for them. For us, I feel like we have to learn to love it, and then we can appreciate it for something, as opposed to have it be around us.
It's partially that, 100%, absolutely. And also the fact that it was pop culture.
Yeah, exactly.
Dance music was, yep, in fact, pop culture.
Exactly.
And at that time, jazz music had a function. Jazz, I hate to say it's changed, but yeah, jazz was function music. It wasn't played just for the sake of playing jazz. It was played because it had a purpose. The purpose is for dancing.
Party.
And because that's part of the unfortunate evolution of jazz, is when it lost its function, it turned into something else.
Right.
I mean, just listen to Basie in 38, listen to Basie in 59. One's a dance band, one's a concert band.
Yeah.
And so what you were saying was just the fact that the jitterbugs of years gone past were first and foremost passionate about their present culture, the culture in which they lived in, which is popular culture.
Yeah.
And so we had a different, you know, today everyone's fucking engineers. And, you know, they hear everything in zeros and ones, and then they're supposed to understand jazz? It's hard. It's not easy. And,
Well, I think for me, in that same sense, it's fine, because no matter what kind of music you're playing, it still can be quantified. It can still put a number to it. But in the same sense, just like everything, like an Eastern philosophy always teaches us, is that you may have that mindset to put analytical thoughts and make things make sense, but you have to have that soul and that part of you that makes no sense, and you put them both together, and I feel like that's like the perfect embodiment of jazz and jazz dance.
Right.
It's like the mind and body working together really succinctly.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And there's two sides to it, and both of them are correct. One side is, however many events you go to, you know, and you jump in the car to get a ride somewhere, and they pop in, they put on the radio, and it's some Britney Spears configuration, you know, and they just hate, you know, that's just what they, you know, they don't live it, is what I'm saying. But then you have the other side of the fence, that they pop in the radio and they go, yeah, I dance to this, totally. I dance to this, I dance to Louis Armstrong, I dance, yeah, to disco, I dance to hip hop, I dance to everything. Why not? It's all danceable music.
Yeah.
So you have two, and they're both correct.
Yeah.
And there is no one answer for everybody, but...
But if you have one, you should try to seek out the other. If you feel music, right, and you can't like think about, like when music pops on, you don't think about numbers, you just think about like feelings and colors, then start maybe thinking about it. But if you think about it a lot and you hear numbers and patterns, then maybe just feel it. Because that's the magic that happens. When she says the idea of magical things can happen, like she really does mean that. We can give you, as dance teachers, we can give you, and you can give yourselves as much like tools and exercises and techniques as you want, but at the end of the day, it's up to you whether you can create the magic for yourself and what you can do with it. Yeah, we can't teach you the magic. We can tell you about it, but that's about it.
And once you have it, leave it. Go break new doors down.
Yeah.
Just because someone opened the door to the house doesn't mean you stand there in the front of the house and looking at the foyer. Go through the house. Look at all the doors. Look at all the music.
Go see what's in the fridge.
Go see what's in the fridge.
Pop a beer.
There's some Afro-Cuban in there. Let's get down.
Let's get down. What's on the TiVo?
Upstairs, there's a little salsa going on. You know, if you're one of those lucky people that are gifted to music, Yes.
Yeah.
Never stop. Yeah. Always keep going, because you're lucky. For some of us, we had to really train our asses off to even understand this thing called swing. So with that said, I think we'll move right on to our last person here.
Well, we didn't get into her video.
That's your problem.
I want to watch
do
the video.
Do we play it? Then
I
we do
watch
it.
The video.
All right. Let's do a little Jean Veloz video.
You know what's so funny is that's when I first saw the clip, it was only that part, and that's when it used to cut off, right there. I was like, right before she started singing, I had no idea it was an actual song. I was like, that's the clip, that's it, that's all it's in. That's all they talked about. There's something very funny about that clip for me, because if you think about it, when you watch a lot of other clips, they split off into different angles, into different things. Maybe they go to the main character for a little bit, and they come back to the dancing, but in that clip, they stay with the dancers the entire time. And apparently Gene said that it was because of Kay Kaiser, and he was on stage next to the woman in black, and it was his movie called Swing Fever, and he made it a point. He's like, look at these dancers, they're really good. Don't look at us, keep the cameras on them. And so that was something that was very important, and like, we wouldn't have this clip if it wasn't for people like that being like, no, showcase the good people. You know, the people over here, like, we're singing and dancing back here, or we're singing and playing back here, but the real show is in front. Like, that's something to really, really take pride in for our dance culture and history.
Well, I think that's the history of dance on film as well.
Yeah.
You guys already know. We have so many wonderful clips from the 30s and 40s where the classic shot is going in the ballroom, wide angle.
Yeah.
Next shot's all the dancers, and the dancers can actually dance.
Yeah.
So you don't have to cut it up. And then, of course, you get some facials, but that changed in the 50s into the 60s, and now today, they just hire people that suck, and they just chop it up and make it look like they can dance, but they can't dance. That's a whole different topic.
Oh, that's a whole different topic.
Yeah, cinematography and dance is a nightmare to get into.
Like making you dance to like 1930s music, and then you see the actual video clip, and then you're dancing to like techno music. And
yeah,
or the fuck just happened there?
Polar Express.
Yeah, exactly. The elves of Polar Express.
The dancers in that film, by the way, is Don Gallagher. He's the army man, and Lenny Smith is the sailor. No, they were neither in the army or the navy. They were 4F. So they were hated by the other dancers who actually did go to war. Don was actually Irene Thomas's boyfriend. Irene Thomas is the brunette in the Groovy movie.
Mm-hmm. The tall one.
She's the one that everybody kind of stole. That's, well,
I, no, that's true. You can say that. They say it all the time. They say they stole moves from her.
They all stole her steps.
Yeah.
But Jean Veloz primarily.
Yeah.
And it's so funny because Irene's still alive too. Mm-hmm. And when you talk to Irene about it, like, you know, what I asked her, what do you think about the people, like, they stole your steps? You know, that's your steps. And she said, oh, honey, I can make up another one.
Yeah.
I make up, you know. But now, Irene Thomas was also a professional tap dancer.
Yeah.
And she did tours during World War II for the USO shows with Bing Crosby and the John Scott Trotter Orchestra. So she was already pretty up there as far as the performers go compared to the other ladies. But
she could care less.
She could care less.
Fun.
But you'll. But something he mentioned earlier when he talked about the shoulders and stuff like this, and I know, I'm only mentioning it because I know you guys run across it on YouTube videos where you see Irene Thomas dancing with Don Gallagher, and they do some kind of a freeze or a quick stop drop or something like that, and Irene does this little shoulder thing. And that was Irene telling Dawn when to bring her back in. She would be backleading him as to when to do it. They had their own little code, like two lefts and a right, and then a left, or something to that degree. I don't remember. I have it written down. But you'll see it on many videos. And that was her way of backleading, or telling Dawn when to bring her back in, like, you know, from open position. So that's number one, and the interesting thing as well, and I always found this very interesting, and I know it has something, it's totally irrelevant to dance and dance history, perhaps, but Don Gallagher, the goody good that he really is in this clip, he was really on the downs. He was a horrible heroin junkie, and I think that's so interesting, because he looks like the most goody good two-shoe blonde boy you've ever seen. Mom must be proud of you. You know, but it's quite the opposite, actually.
Like Don was left to this lecture. Don't do drugs, kids.
Right. The history is
don't do drugs.
Legalize. Like Portugal. Portugal has it. I don't know. You're Oregon, Washington. No, it has nothing to do with that. But I just thought it was so interesting because in the movies he looks so nice.
He
in
does,
all the
yeah.
Clips.
It's very true.
And it's like Irene.
I mean,
really?
There's other stories too. I mean, like for sure, like other stories about people like Lenny or something like that. That I was like, whoa, they look so like nice people. So this idea, especially in America, I feel like I don't know how it is in different European states, but in America, when you think about swing dancing, you're like, that's the greatest generation. That is that we did nothing wrong. We put our boots on and we fucking killed this country and we made ourselves better. And we're like, well, okay, that's great. And then when you go back and you talk to these people, they're like, no, I carried a gun. I carried a shit with me. Are you kidding me? I live in LA.
Yeah.
It was hard times.
You guys all heard of the ballroom called the Palladium. It's a very famous Hollywood ballroom. And opened in 1941 with Tommy Dorsey's orchestra. But they had a thing there called the Palladium Totem Pole. I don't know if you guys know what a totem pole is, but it's a Native American pole with sculptures on it that tells a story or something to this degree.
Large piece of timber.
Right. And the Palladium had a totem pole, and it was because of Lenny Smith. The Lenny Smith or the Palladium totem pole was when you first enter the Palladium, you dance with the masses, which is 2,000 people doing the box step.
This place was huge.
And which is, of course, the box step is nothing more than a little 8 count, body to body, nothing special going on there. And then when you're good enough, you can actually graduate up the ladder to the next, which is the corner of the room where it's a jam session. And the jam session would be going on all night long. In one shape or another. It didn't matter the tempo. It was always a jam session in the front corner. And that would be the Lindy dancers, the swing dancers, and the shaggers all together going for it. So you have to graduate to get to that corner. And then once you get to that corner, Lenny Smith, I'm speaking of specifically, then the next place you graduate to is the back seat of your car in the parking lot. You finally got good enough. You don't need to dance anymore. So your evening is spent in the backseat having sex in the end, and that was the whole thing of the Palladium with Lenny Smith. And that's why you see him dancing with so many partners, because one partner's pregnant, because she's at home, so somebody else is jumping in, either as his partner or as a babysitter or whatever the case may be. And so this is epic LA history that and I'm not just saying only a few people knew about this. No. Everybody knew about the totem pole at the Palladium. You start at the front door.
Literally.
You start at the front door and you work your way to the front, to the back seat.
Yeah.
And it's just an interesting concept because of the fact that it's hard for us today, for good reasons, I think, that we don't think like that anymore. You know, like,
don't get pregnant, kids.
Right. I don't want to get so good that I stop dancing. I mean, that's a weird thing. But back then, it wasn't a weird thing at all.
Yeah, of course.
To get so good that, okay, I did it.
Yeah, you kind of drop out.
You conquered it, and now you're done with it, you know.
I mean,
dancing, not the relationship.
I mean, that's a lot of people. That's a lot of people back where we grew up. Like, I think it's me, you, and Nick Williams are like the only ones from LA really continuing it. Like, they started in LA and are still doing it nowadays. Out of the thousands of people,
Mike is shagging all over the place now.
Oh, that's right. He's getting back out there.
It's so cool to see that guy out
he's
there.
Back in the show.
At our age, or yeah. My age, not yours.
No, not yours.
Like, why, dude? You're.
Thank you.
You can pay probably the same as me, and you're doing slow, slow, quick all day long.
Oh, yeah.
That's boring.
I know, I'm so good. I don't drop my beer.
No. That's why I don't do slow.
Okay, so we gotta put old man Peter back to bed. But before we do, is there any questions out there? Anybody have anything they'd like, or comments, or observations?
I know there's a few questions out there. They might be too embarrassed to ask right now. But the bar at tonight, they're gonna be all
yeah, I know,
on
seriously.
Our shit, jocking us.
Seriously, every time.
Now's your opportunity. Especially because, look it, I can't tell you one answer because I have Mikey here to test my answer.
Yeah.
And vice versa.
Yeah.
So right now is a really good time for a question, especially if it's an LA question.
Yeah. Or not.
There we go.
Yeah, go for it.
I'd like to know how Christofferson
George?
God, I love you.
George? George Christofferson?
Yes.
So, okay, well, that's a mixed bag of stuff.
What do you remember from him?
Oh, Jesus.
I'm curious. I didn't
actually get to see him. Okay. I never got a chance because I was too young to go to the clubs y'all were going to.
George is the reason we have the Jack and Jills today. George is one of those people that was winning every single week after week. And you had about 10 different couples always competing. This is 49, 50, 51, 52. Those are the years. And so you had all these people always competing for the same trophy, and they're always coming in second or third because of George. And so Jack, at the time, his name was Jack Dawsey. Jack and Lorraine Dawsey, who would become Jack Carey later on. Jack said, you know what, hey you guys, why don't we just put our dance partners' names in a hat? And why don't we just draw the names out of a hat? What do you guys think of that? Of course, George didn't give a shit. George is like, sure, I don't give a hell with anybody.
George is drunk.
And so that's what happened. That's how Jack and Jill started. And yes, George continued to win. It didn't make a difference. George was a one-man show.
Yeah, he really was. There was a great story with him dancing with Frida Angelou. And it was, they were doing a, I think it was maybe a performance. I don't think it was a contest. And they were doing some performance just in front of people and whatnot. And she couldn't find him. She's like, where's George? And no one could find him. And then they called out her name and called out George and they started playing the music and she's out there by herself and she feels embarrassed. And all of a sudden she's looking at the crowd and the crowd's going, duck. She's like, duck, yeah, duck. And she ducks and George comes running from the other side, from the bar, running from the other side, jumps over her and goes to do a splits and then like into the audience. And everybody's like, the audience had no idea he was just getting wasted right before he just heard his name and he saw Frida out there, so he started running after her. That was about it.
That was his entrance.
That was his entrance.
For all competitions. He would spin the follower out into the floor and then run out, dive over, into a somersault and slide on his knees to the edge.
But for me, in my sense, and you have a better idea about this, George was more of a later dancer, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, he didn't really come in until like later 40s or 50s even?
Yeah.
Same with Frida?
Yeah, and he won the California State Championships about 4 or 5 years in a row. One of the times he did the somersault over his partner and slid across the floor, he slid all the way across the floor and crashed into the bandstand.
Yeah.
And it was a sad thing because he hit the drum set, which hit the drummer, which hit the saxophone player, which hit the sax through the guy's cheek.
Oh.
And they had to take the guy to the hospital right there on the spot. That was in San Diego when they had the championships. George was a crazy son of a bitch. He never grew up. He lived in his grandkids' garage. Literally, in a garage. No running water, nothing. He lived like a hobo in Huntington Beach, surfer. He loved to smoke weed. He would be dancing in front of you at Golden Sales.
Yeah.
And you'd be sitting there watching, going, yeah, you know, show me something, George, or whatever. And he would fake a heart attack. fall on the ground, and then he would take his breathalyzer out, and then jump up out of it, and then you go crazy, you know. Like, he was a comedian, dancer, one-man show his whole life. I can go on and on and on about George.
There's not a ton of clips out there, but the couple that there are really showcase him at his best.
I put all the clips that you see online of him up there, from starting in 54, 55, and then there's some from 70, 71. Unfortunately, it's black and white, but you can see it. It's online, and it's so cool, because if you look closely, his hair is actually, he's got two ponytails, like Pippi Longstocking. And his hair, you can't see it in the clip, but it's actually pink. He was like punk rock before there was such a thing as punk rock.
Yeah.
But that's George. I can go on and on about George, but I better, yeah.
So to sum up everything, I think the things we learn about from all these old timers is that each one of them are different. Each one of them have their dark stories. Each one of them have their great stories. And so just like all of us, like we should learn off of that. We should know that there's no way, one way to be a perfect dancer or be even perfect person. It's just to like use our experiences, go forward, smoke a lot of weed if we want to. And just keep the dance alive for our own selves, for our own being, you know, because I think every single one of us in here is here for the same reason. We're looking for a really good dance this weekend.
Yeah.
I think hopefully we're all going to find it as long as we keep that in mind.
And I think that's absolutely it. And the one thing from the old timers that was brought to us is the fact that no matter how you vote, no matter how you dress, no matter what your beliefs are, the dance is where we all come together. That's what the old timers brought to me. Diversity, and if you don't want to hear it, don't ask. And the dance is what brings us together. And I think that's really, really important in this day and age, especially this year, of all years, in the way politics are and shit.
I mean, we were just talking about this earlier, and this is exactly what I'm talking about. It transcends the idea of borders and countries.
Absolutely.
And cultural ideals. We're a subculture that can create our own new ideas, and hopefully for the betterment of ourselves and the betterment of the world around us. I know that sounds kind of like the hippy dippy thing, but it really is. Like, it's an amazing way to think about it, and don't feel embarrassed to think about it or try to strive for it. So with that, thank you, Peter.
Right on, Mikey.
Thank you, Kisses. Thank you, Harlem.
Thank you, guys. Thank you guys for signing up. We'll see you guys tonight at 8 at Comstar.